Right, welcome Ravenface to Hammerdown 2023, a band that I personally wanted to book for years and years. We've never had a chance to work together yet. I discovered you in about 2018 or 19, just after the record drops, through an Instagram advert. How important do you think social media is for bands in 2023 in terms of gaining new fans and followers?
Very important.
That's vital.
We started on MySpace. We had like literally nothing. It was a bedroom.
It was just a bedroom
and we had no experience. We were very young. And that enabled us to kind of reach, I think there was a point where we were getting, you know, thousands of plays a day.
Really?
Undeserved, by the way. We were terrible. Like,
this was the first record before you re-recorded it?
No, this was long this time was like EPs and EPs.
Really? Oh, long time, man, long time, wow.
Maybe 2010?
I'd say
yeah, well,
seven.
We had a five-year hiatus for a while. So
yeah.
Not like we've been totally active all the time, but to answer your question, very important. I think it allows bands with out any sort of connection, or maybe they're not in like London, which is kind of the hub of music, to just reach a lot of people and to kind of get out there. However, it has become very saturated, so it is harder than ever.
Yeah. I mean, do you have any tips for newer bands? Like, you're very good with the social media, we're chatting a lot about that. Do you have any tips for young aspiring bands on how to gain following over social media? Any words of wisdom you've got?
Everything you put out, make it as professional as you would expect to see from your favourite band.
Nice.
Like, don't learn on the job. Don't put out something that's just kind of like, you know, rough. Okay. Yeah, rough, exactly. Like, make it polished. Go to a good producer. Merrick is a full-time...
he's quite good, actually.
Full-time professional producer, works with many, many bands, but I mean...
Glad I came to this now,
let's see.
Yeah.
Bit
it's not a plug, but I'm just saying, you know...
No, it's true. Yeah, absolutely.
Make sure it's... Any what you would expect to see from your favourite band, try and emulate that, not in terms of copying their music, but copy the level of professionalism. Because, you know, people will see that on your page and they'll treat you as they find you. If you look amateur, you know, like you've just started, even if that's true, that's probably how they'll take it.
That's just, you need to have a high level of quality just to kind of break
absolutely
through the saturation. Because everyone can do an average job.
If you
constantly put out like high quality things, then you've got a much higher chance of breaking through that kind of saturation.
Yeah,
definitely.
I'd also say, don't focus too much on numbers of like likes and stuff.
Yeah.
Like, you want to make an organic fan base.
Don't buy likes.
I really do focus on that, actually. It's really interesting to say that. Why don't you say not to then? Because I'm really focused on how many likes and shares.
Oh, because like you can get tons of likes, but what do they transfer to a live gig? If you've got likes, like either bought likes or likes from around the world, you can have a band turning up with an Instagram following and say 50,000. But if that's not an organic thing that's been built up over years,
no one's going to come to your gigs.
You're going to play a gig to no one because they're not real people.
That makes a lot of sense. Yeah.
Okay. So like you can advertise online a lot, and that does help. It gets your name out there.
Yeah.
But you have to make sure it's targeted to the right people. You don't want to just get random people playing your stuff just to get the numbers up so you can go to someone and say, look how many views we've got.
Yeah, makes sense.
I would focus more on trying to get Spotify playlisting over likes, if you're a band, obviously.
Okay.
Because, I mean, that's people listening to your music. Like,
sure.
They can like a post or whatever, but getting on a good playlist kind of gets you in with, you know, a group that you want to be with. Say it's your kind of style of music, getting on, like, I don't know, you're a adrenaline sort of rock band, getting on a good sort of gym playlist or whatever.
Nice.
That's how we've got a huge amount of our following has come from.
Really?
I think Be Silent, our most successful song, that was on a bodybuilding video. It's like 50 million views.
Wow, no way.
Literally, that's our most successful song.
Yeah, and it's that not, video, yeah.
It's not hard to see why that one is.
Yeah, that makes so much sense. Wow, that's mad, brother. That's cool. All right. So like, you guys have been relatively quiet post-pandemic, but then Sting kind of came out of nowhere. Is there more in the pipeline? Is there other unreleased stuff? Is there anything that's been worked on? I agree. Give us some. But is there? Talk to us. What's going on at the moment?
Am I answering this one?
Yeah, I can't really
answer this one.
Yes, but I also think we all have kind of moved from the point where Ravenface is like our career to the point where we just kind of take gigs that we enjoy, we're writing on the back burner, we get together. I think, you know, we want to like get other musicians involved. Like, I'd love to get Merrick involved. Merrick's from Exist Immortal, for anyone that's not aware.
They're quite good also.
Rather good, played here last year, obviously. But getting some different musicians involved, trying to keep it like
fresh.
fresh as well, and also no pressure, because I feel like you can put a lot of pressure on yourselves with writing music.
Yeah, very true.
And if you spend like, you know, 6, 7, 8, 9 months writing an album, the same people, it can grind you down a bit. So
yeah, definitely.
If you take the pressure off, I think the stuff is better.
So, your band's got a lot of history, right? Mm-hmm. We've already kind of touched upon that. Any band that have MySpace has a lot of history. So, how have you seen yourselves evolve over the last 15 years or whatever it's been? How have you seen yourselves develop as a band, as musicians?
Well, I mean, like, the lineup's changed. Like, me and James are the only like members that have been there,
there you go.
For the long haul.
Yeah, cool.
And like every album,
we're kind of the core writers, though. Yeah, so that's why.
Yeah. Well, that makes sense. Right? Yeah.
And I suppose like the style from each album has a natural progression.
Mm-hmm.
But like, I don't know. What do you reckon?
Well, how it's changed.
I mean, you can see how it's changed. Like, it was very much in 2012.
It was kind of metalcore. And that fan base is, from an outsider's perspective, the fan base has matured.
Yeah.
I think.
Because everybody's old now.
But I mean, I think as their songwriting has gone from like a more MySpace age.
With the hair.
I have more hair than everyone here, but
Yeah.
Jack doesn't really care.
I haven't hair anymore.
So, how do you think as a band that experience helps you now, especially in a life setting like this? Because there are a lot of younger bands that would have seen what you guys have done, and it's the same goes for Exist and what you guys have been around the block a few times.
So we met from a tour, like,
yeah,
really?
Okay. 20 years ago.
Wow, okay, so a lot of bands look up to people like yourselves, they do, and how do you think that experience serves you at a life setting?
It gives you really important life lessons on how to deal with people, how to manage people, how to kind of...
We had a bit of that last year.
You learn how to work in a group properly with people, trying to achieve something. You learn how to, like, if you do gigs abroad as well, you learn how to...
Yeah.
There's all that logistical stuff, so you become quite good at people managing.
Nice.
And like just making stuff happen.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the thing, you kind of become, like the ones who stick at it become quite good at like completing things and making things, getting things done.
True.
Which I think a lot of people generally struggle with. Lots of people have lots of ideas, but actually following through with ideas.
I struggle with it.
I've unfinished
projects I've got.
For example, like making a tour happen or writing an album or an EP,
that
involves a lot of like
logistics
and like got to do this and this and this and this and like following it all the way through. That's a really important lesson that you kind of, it's quite hard to, it's learning it through like a band scenario is quite a good way of doing it.
Yeah, cool.
Because it's all off your own.
You put yourself in front of every possible personality type, I suppose.
Yeah, exactly.
For me, it was like, for me, it was like, it gives you a nice peace of mind that the people have got it. So we played Bulgaria last year. We were like main support to Slipknot, which is obviously a career highlight.
That's the one show.
Yes.
In 13 years that I've missed.
That's why I
was pissed off.
That wasn't there.
You're joking.
He was completely offered to come back.
I just couldn't do it.
But it was like
one show.
I knew going out on stage that everybody had a hell of a load of experience.
Sure.
I wasn't worried about anything. You know, I was worried about myself, obviously. I wanted to perform.
Of course, you want to give your best.
I wasn't looking over at Merrick thinking, God, does he know the words? Like, because he's been on many tours, this many times, and so has everyone. So I think it just gives you that, like, peace of mind that you've got.
And that transfers to the stage, by the way, of course it does. Makes a big difference, doesn't it?
Hugely, yeah. If you look like you know what you're doing,
It
gives you a lot of important life experience as well.
So Bulgaria is the first show you were involved in, am I correct in that? So how did that relationship come about then? Because I understand that was because you weren't there then.
Yeah,
so
why are you
But firstly, how did that relationship come about? Is that because of your touring a while ago? And secondly, why does that work with all of you now? Because that's fucking cool, by the way.
Yeah.
That you're all here.
We met on an Exim Ravenface tour way back in the day.
Wow.
We were all quite wet behind the ears then.
Yeah.
We were all just a lot younger. But then since then, you know, we've gone on to write several more albums. Exim have continued. Merrick is like a very accomplished producer. So
yeah.
As a friend and a good vocalist, he seemed like a natural choice. And also, we get on well. Yeah. I like America a lot. which always helps.
But why did you want a third vocalist though?
He's the second vocalist technically, because so Jackie's second vocals,
mm-hmm. yeah.
but wasn't available for the show. So there are many parts that would have gone unsung then. Merrick comes in to do the second vocals.
Yeah, okay.
This one.
Jack drops back down to focus more on the guitars. Okay. Yeah. Merrick can be.
Oh, so you're doing Jack's parts mostly?
Yeah. I still have the odd bit, but essentially, like.
That's great with three. I think that's cool, man. That's sick.
It actually really works.
Yeah. The conversation me and James had, it was like, the show went so well with that two frontman dynamic.
It did.
He basically said, would you be alright with having Merrick on this show doing a lot of your parts because it worked so well? And I know Merrick for years and know what a great frontman he is, what a great vocalist he is. I was happy to let him like take those parts. I can then go back, concentrate on the guitar. Yeah. Still have parts where I join
it. Yeah, you still do some bits. Like there's some parts where it just makes this. There's some really cool parts actually in the set where we have like a proper three vocal.
Oh,
yeah.
Mate, I can't wait.
It is really cool.
On the record, there's lots of vocals at parts.
Yeah, sure.
You can either put them on the backing track or this gives us the opportunity to actually do them live. Yeah, which is always the preference.
You get to kind of focus on playing guitar as well. Mm-hmm. Which
like I found on the most recent tours we did when I was doing vocals and guitar, I had so much to concentrate on that it almost felt like I didn't take in the actual gigs. Mm. I didn't have chance
to you want to do that when you
step back and just kind of look at it, because if I wasn't playing, I was singing. Mm. And so this gives me an opportunity, because as I said, we don't really play that many shows anymore. I really want to enjoy this one.
Definitely.
So definitely. This gives me the opportunity to really enjoy it.
Nice. And for future reference, obviously, you got merch here today, yeah?
No.
But where can fans get involved moving forward? Is there merch online? Can people buy your music? And is anything coming up in the pipeline that people really
all the normal places you would consume music, YouTube, Spotify, Amazon, iTunes. Yes, we will definitely do something in the future.
Yeah,
I think
good to it.
We're all sort of, you know, music is in your DNA when you've done it for 15 years. So not writing music seems like a bit of a, you know, going against your own sort of DNA.
It's not an answer, really. It's not writing music.
It's not an option. I've not written music for a year, and like I dream about songwriting. Like my body's telling me something.
And doing shows like this kind of reminds you of. I guarantee after this show it'll be like, oh, we should write something.
We should write some stuff, man.
Well, I hope that inspires something. I'd love that.
It's 100% will. That'd be amazing. 100%.
I do like the people as well. I love. There's two parts to being in a band. There's this bit, which is the good bit, where you see people you know, you have like a proper sort of community vibe. Then there's the like 15 hours of driving, playing to four people in like Cumbria.
We've all been there, man.
That kills the vibe a bit. But if you can sort of just have this bit, then that's like perfect situation.
The thing is what you were saying there, and it relates to the question you asked earlier. Like every single show that you play, regardless of it's like main spot Slipknot or four people in Cumbria, for a younger band, if they're doing that, it's a learning curve. Every single
take those gigs.
Mm-hmm. It's a lesson.
Yeah, it
so
is.
Then
it
that's
is.
How
that's how bands evolve, man.
That's how it happens.
Yeah.
Well, Ravenface, thank you for being here and having a show with us, because that's really cool. So.
Cool, man.
Thanks for coming.
Excited.
Thank you. Check out Ravenface. Listen to all the records online. They're amazing. And yeah, we'll see you guys very shortly on stage.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.